subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
Hi, welcome to Elonomics. It's time to take a health check of the economy. Actually, it's always a good time to take a health check of the economy, but this week there have been several developments that is giving us a reason to take a helicopter view of what's happening. The RBI came out with its annual report, and the RBI has made several serious analysis of what's happening with the Indian economy in the light of the coronavirus COVID pandemic. And subsequently, the RBI governor also has been talking about what's going on. And then the states and the center are locked over GST. There are serious issues around us. And the RBI's annual report paints a very worrying picture. What is that worrying picture, Ila?
So one serious worry now that the RBI has expressed is about the fiscal situation in the country. So already, if we look back, then even the previous year, the year before the coronavirus and the lockdown, which is 1920, already the fiscal situation was difficult. The deficit turned out to be higher according to, the revised estimate. So initially we were supposed to be on track, more or less on track, but then it turned out that the deficit was actually, we'll know the actuals a year later, but from what we know, which are known as, so first the budget estimates come out, then the revised estimates come out the following year. And finally, when the full picture is clear, then the year after that the actuals come out. So now we have the revised estimates of the previous year, and they're already showing that there was a fiscal slippage. The real concern is this year. This year there is going to be a significant fiscal slippage. The worrying fact is that we don't even actually know how much. There are going to be both revenue side reasons for the slippage, and there are going to be expenditure side reasons for the slippage. So revenue side, there will be a decline in tax revenue. And I think we're really seeing a lot of that tension between the GST compensation issue that has arisen. Then on the expenditure side, the government had come out with a package where it's going to borrow something like 4 lakh crores more. That is going to mean that its borrowing is going to be higher. So overall, the deficit picture, and along with that, the debt picture, government debt picture, is a matter of concern for the RBI and, of course, for the economy and the government.
The annual report, Ila, said the fiscal space for the union government will be severely diminished, and that will not allow the union government, the central government, to help revive the economy. And this is something which is worrying even the RBI, the central government, the going forward, because we still are in the middle of the pandemic. And just yesterday, that is Thursday, the RBI governor talked about how the inability to predict the pandemic and how it will shape is an area of concern. He's not even able to give estimates of the GDP.
Absolutely. The estimates of GDP depend on your perception of what is happening in the economy. And because even now there are many states that are still going into lockdown, there are many states, many areas, especially industrial supply chains, where something comes from one place and something and go somewhere else. So there are, on the way, there are disruptions. Now, the RBI has, through its various surveys as well, looked at where are we roughly on the, where we were compared to last year. Now, if you compare us to where we were in the pre-pandemic days, then industries is at about 80% or so, 70 to 80% or so. And the question today is not even about what is the growth rate that we are going to see, but about what might be the contraction and where might we be in contrast to the output levels of the pre-pandemic days. So let me just very clearly distinguish this, because people say that, this year the growth rate will be slower, but next year the growth rate will be very high. Okay, but let's just step back from growth rates for a minute and talk about, are we going to be back at the pre-pandemic output levels? So will we be producing what we were producing last year, or last financial year? So, you know, where we were was that in February, the budget was presented, and the budget made an estimate of about 10% nominal growth. And now we know that we are at about 70-80% of where we were at that time. So that 10% nominal growth is not happening. And in terms of the uncertainty, even to make a prediction, even to make an estimate of GDP growth, of to make estimates along with that of tax revenue, is very, very difficult. So that's, I think, the picture where we are and where many other countries in the world today are.
The point, Ila, you make about growth rates is also misleading, in the sense that, you know, next year it will be better because this year the base is so, I mean, there is no base. It's a horrific base. But the argument in your column, Elonomics, which we will be giving the link to in the description of the video, is about the fiscal deficit targets and how they seem to constrain, or is that a correct analysis, that they seem to build some kind of a wall around government policies that, you know, they cannot somehow maneuver themselves because of this restraint. Is that a correct analysis?
Now, we do have FRBM targets, which we will be going off the target. So there's no question that we will be going off the target, both in terms of debt and in terms of deficit, in terms of the general center plus states, we will not be able to meet those targets. But I think that is not, people are not treating that as a binding constraint, because you had a very extraordinary event. You had an event where you both demand and supply have got hit. And there is no doubt, you know, there's no doubt in anybody's mind that you can't meet those targets. They're meant for normal times and not for such extraordinary times. I think the question is that even within this period, you know, we still have to maintain fiscal, some sort of, I won't call it fiscal prudence, because it's not really, you know, fiscal prudence in terms of meeting those targets. But we still have to be fiscally prudent, in the sense that if you say, go ahead and borrow as much as possible, go ahead and print money, which is where it comes to, because there aren't too many sources from which you can borrow. So if you, you know, even if the government borrows away all the additional savings that people might have made, because as, you know, the RBI points out that they're, are additional savings, discretionary expenditure is not happening. So weddings are not happening, parties are not happening, tourism is not happening, a lot of travel that would happen is not happening. And that's the discretionary expenditure. So not just your essential, but beyond that, that is not happening. And savings have increased. So you, even if you take those into account, then also the needs of pushing expenditure of government relief measures can be so high. If we just went completely unconstrained, then they can be so high that those are not going to be enough, and that we have to either borrow from abroad, so that's external dollar-denominated borrowing, or even rupee-denominated borrowing abroad. So we either have to borrow abroad or we have to print money. Now, you know, you can do a little bit of both, but you don't even know today how bad the situation is. You don't know how bad it's going to be. So given that, I think it's a sensible policy not to go overboard. Mm-hmm. But what we do point out, so Radhika Pandey, my co-author, and I do point out that at this time, transparency would help. Mm-hmm. So, you know, instead of letting the budget deficit stand, the growth numbers, GDP numbers stand at where they were, I think it's time now, we are kind of in the middle of the year, sort of a mid-year assessment, that where does the budget deficit, where does government borrowing stand, and maybe the government needs to come out with some very clear numbers. So we've got numbers from RBI. I mean, and every economist is trying to make projections of this. But it would be very useful and in the interest of the government bond market and how government bonds do, that there be greater transparency, because we no longer can the assumptions of the budget hold. So obviously those assumptions have changed. So looking forward, what would be the kind of expectations we have? Recognizing very fully well that these could actually change, you know, as if the lockdown extends further, if we don't control the disease, then they could change for the worse. While if the lockdown does go away, suppose a vaccine comes and we do better, I mean, or for whatever reasons we are able to, immunity increases and we are able to get back to work, then we can always revise them upwards. But I think at this point, you know, also looking at what's happening in other emerging economies, at this point, it is important that there is greater transparency about what might be the assumptions, what might be the expectations. Can we revise our budget expectations for this year, estimates for this year?
Transparency is one thing. You talked about revising estimates, but you're also talking about taking a relook at the fiscal deficit target itself. Is that only for this fiscal year, Ila, or are you talking about a longer term, realignment of the fiscal deficit target?
See, you will have your debt targets will have to go up, and there will have to be a glide path. Deficit also, you know, once your interest payments increase, if you borrow more this year, then your interest payments increase. Either you really go into contraction mode from next year, which also will not be possible. So realistically speaking, even if, let's say we have a vaccine in March and everybody goes back to work in March, and, there are no COVID-related restrictions, just hype. You know, for the sake of argument, this, let's say there are no COVID-related restrictions after the month of March. So in the next financial year, there are absolutely no restrictions. Even in that scenario, see, you're going to get a lot of impaired balance sheets of companies, balance sheets of banks are going to be in difficulty. And the government will be paying out more interest, would have given various measures to support, and they can't all suddenly be withdrawn. And you can expect that this won't be just a one-time until 31st March adjustment, but will need to go into next year. Because next year, you will still have to do a lot of the repair work that is required for getting the economy back on track after the lockdown is completely lifted, after people are more confident in moving around. And let's say after, let's just assume that everybody's vaccinated, still think about, let's say the airline industry. The airline industry is going to be in trouble, not because they can't start operating from 1st of April, but because of the economic difficulties of this year. Similarly, hotels, restaurants, and many, many other services would continue to be, they would have paid out a lot of cash. Many would have taken on debt, and they are going to not be back on their feet as much as one would like to see, even if the COVID restrictions go away.
Last quick question, Ila. This face-off between the central government and the states over GST dues. What is the way out of this, if you have a way out?
It's a very difficult situation. You see, both are right in their own way, in the sense that, yes, the center has said that we will give you compensation, but it's not as if the center is getting money and keeping it and not giving it. It's not as if the center has received, so GST revenue has crashed. So if I look at the overall situation, then somebody has to borrow. Either the central government has to borrow or the state government has to borrow for the committed expenditures of state governments. So state governments would have to go through a expenditure contraction, but they would still, there are committed expenditures for which they would need money. And either they have to go out into the market or the central government has to go into the market. Now, I think the problem lies at the not just about whether it should be the center or state governments which borrows and give the money, but the fact that we haven't had government bond market reforms. I mean, that is a reform that has been there on the agenda for a very long time. And I don't know how many times we've talked about it in this very show, but I mean, it is critical at this time. And I think an issue like this really brings it out that why don't either central or state governments feel confident. State governments would of course prefer that the center does the borrowing, and the center would prefer that the states do the borrowing. But what it does bring out is that the need for a market where you can borrow. I mean, you know, so otherwise it could have been that the central government was going to borrow at much cheaper rates or much easier for it to borrow. But today when you ask me, then I would, say that at the end of it, we might need to have the central government borrow because it is the one that has more credibility. So the states borrowing, in case their borrowing pushes up their interest rates, and in a very small, shallow market, this may not be the best thing to do. So the borrowing might have ultimately to be by the central government. But, you know, it is a difficult situation, and the fact that there isn't a bond market where you can easily borrow makes it all the more difficult.
It is a difficult situation in more ways than one, and that is, the not so fantastic news from this health check of the Indian economy. Thank you for watching this episode of Elonomics. We will be back with you in next week with another episode. And I would also like to thank all our viewers for taking subscriptions of the print. And if you have not done so, please do go to our theprint.in/subscriptions page and take subscriptions, because good journalism needs people to pay for what they read and view. Thank you very much. We will be back next week with another episode.